It's a 8 o'clock break, and I cleverly placed that bowl there to skip a few slides because we're going to only really touch on the most essential ones for the Renaissance era research, and that's going to be Alicia Danforth's study that she did with Charles Grove and others at UCLA, and this was the reduction in social anxiety after MDMA-assisted psychotherapy with autistic adults. So it was a randomized, double-blind, placebo-controlled study. And by the end of the study, they also did a crossover, so everyone was able to receive MDMA, which I think should be like almost a law that, like, if you're in a psychedelic study, like, there was an unfortunate incident in a Hopkins study where a gentleman actually suicided because he thought he got the psilocybin and he thought it didn't do anything. And so they couldn't inform him because they couldn't break the blind. So they actually, like, they ended their life before they were told that they had not received psilocybin. It's a weird, like, hill to stand on and be like, make sure you do a crossover study, or at least, like, question whether or not the placebo is that essential to really validate these medicines over, like, that level of, like, duping someone and being like, oh, it didn't work, or whatever. I don't know, didn't mean to, like, bring the level all the way down, but, like, that's a reality. So this study did do a cross, which is great. Celebrate, they did it. They gave everyone the chance to still experience it, but they wanted to test it, those who got the MDMA versus not. There was only 12 subjects. It takes a lot of money to do a study, especially with the Schedule 1 compound. They had 8 subjects that were given MDMA, 4 subjects with placebo, and they used the Liebowitz Social Anxiety Scale, which is a fairly common scale used in other studies as a comparison and baseline to 1 month after, and then follow-up. And as far as how the study was architected, the 8 participants received that MDMA anywhere from 75 to 125. MDMA is dosed by body weight. In this instance, they were controlling for that in certain ways. As well as it was like what's known as like a dose finding. So they were also seeing like how well tolerated was it at a lower level versus a higher, trying to detect some patterns, kind of get the maximum amount of data out of one small data pool that they could. And all participants got 3 prep sessions that were 60 to 90 minutes that involved no medicine, and then also afterwards. So in other words, in total they had 9 prep or integration sessions with kind of 2 kind of wedged in the middle. So like 3 dose, 3 dose, and then follow-up 3. And those dosing sessions were 8 hours long, and they had 2 practitioners present to support and to simultaneously support each other as practitioners, like overseeing that amount of observation and such. But this chart, which I'll show slightly larger on the next one, hopefully it's big enough to see-ish, but essentially the blue line is the MDMA group, and it correlates to their anxiety score levels, and that kind of solid line there is kind of like the clinical level of like significance. So as you see, like the MDMA line dipped down below and became clinically significant and remained all the way down to 6-month follow-up. And here it was reduced, but did not become any more than just around clinically significant. Again, just small numbers, but it's worth noting. And it's also worth noting, if you look at Goldalen's work, which is oriented around, hey, MDMA doesn't just work for 5 hours. It might work for like 3 weeks, and it might work for a lot longer than that. If you can build lasting changes in that open critical period reopening, then it makes sense if you're going to therapy for the next subsequent weeks that you're going to be more psychologically flexible in your therapy sessions, go even further with progress than you might in the drug session itself. So this was really validating. I mean, kudos to MAPS for doing it. It was like an amazing thing that they decided to like target that specifically. It was really kind of like a novel study at the time. Didn't necessarily need to happen in that sequence, probably a little early in like the conventional pipeline for something like this, but they validated it. And this data alone goes very far to being able to make like the 2024 psychiatrists of the world comfortable prescribing this for assisted therapies. Those of you guys that don't know, there's already probably thousands of people that already hold MDMA certificates in the world. They just can't practice because the drug is against the law. So once we get that taken care of, those people will be activated. And that's a lot of autistic people that could probably be relieved from a lot of anxiety that they carry. Again, it just like they found out, they recently, not MAPS, but another organization did an alcoholism study. They basically found out that they enrolled alcoholics, but they eventually found out it was a trauma healing study. They were just like, oh, all these people just are traumatized, and they have maladaptive strategies for navigating that. So, like, everything, like, not everything is trauma or whatever, but a lot of these, like, really, really intense presentations, there's some element of, like, really something that's really in the way, and MDMA is great for allowing for a safe, like, feeling back into, like, you know, that origin of any, like, previous experience, or just purely, like, feeling safe enough to feel into the body to be present for oneself. But this study just validated it in every possible way. It was a very successful outcome, and will, again, be leveraged in future for being able to kind of justify even, like, off-label use, even if it's not for PTSD. There's a decent chance that through the REMS model, in other words, like, risk evaluation management, looking at, like, sort of, like, oh, well, if the detriment of the known neurotoxicity isn't that high for this medication, we might be able to justify the use of it for addressing social anxiety, for addressing other things.
Who was the researcher on it?
This was Danforth and Charles Grobe. It was out of UCLA. And the full bibliography I'll send in the follow-up email as well. Yeah, and Dr. Danforth has spoken publicly often on these topics. I think now she works in palliative care work, and does also still autism-like therapy practice. Question?
Yeah, I just wanted to point out, a lot of you may know, you mentioned, you know, the effects could last 3 weeks or whatever. The MDMA studies that MAPS has done in PTSD show huge effects 6 months and even 12 months later. So there's ways in which it really can be curative, at least in PTSD.
For sure. And when I was mentioning that, some of that was to do with, like, the action of, like, what's known as, like, critical period.
Yeah.
And, like, but the still the follow-up, yeah, to your point as well, like, the follow-up can, long-term follow-up can still be showing that same, the idea of, like, seizing those windows in which the critical period might be the most, like, accessible for plasticity and influence.
Am I correct? This study was not doing therapy under the MDMA, or was it?
It was, so they were administered, and they were still there with support during the sessions.
Yeah.
But the primary, like, progress was made in, like, the prep and integration sessions as well. So then, with this next glance, and again, I'm moving, kind of treading lightly. This one, very simply, was just a general. This is not an autistic study. This was just an observance. The kind of stuff that we're looking to do in Colorado is kind of why I want to talk about it here. This was just at a psilocybin retreat in the Netherlands, which is vaguely going to resemble what Oregon might. And they were just, like, giving people baseline surveys, giving them psilocybin, and then giving them follow-up surveys. It's just one semi-empirical piece of evidence that shows that these individuals, which again, were not autistic, they were just general, they weren't, like, classified by any previous diagnostic, but after taking psilocybin in the morning of this retreat, they were instructed to stay on the retreat premises, kind of giving, like, freedom to roam in that space. They had music, tools to draw and reflect. The next morning, they then had breakfast, sharing circle, kind of like a common retreat kind of model. But they took the outcomes from that, and they showed that they had enhanced divergent thinking, in other words, like, coming up with new or novel solutions, or reconsidering problems through a different lens. Also enhanced, like, emotional empathy as well, at, like, 7-day follow-up. And that study also found that psilocybin increased well-being, and that changes in self-rated, implicit, or explicit emotional empathy were correlated also with changes in well-being. This is, like, a science-y way of saying, like, these people felt better, and they felt more flexible. On our UCL study survey data, we had about 300 participants, and one of the main kind of connecting points that the researchers wanted to kind of tell in terms of, like, the kind of, like, in the overview was just to kind of emphasize that psychological flexibility seemed to be, like, a kind of a common thread through which all of these kind of positive outcomes seem to be predicted through, like, the increases in psychological flexibility, not just for being able to kind of rethink life events, but also, like, dynamically rethinking, like, situations, like, perspective taking in the moment, having that, like, enhanced flexibility and creativity as seen in some of these kind of more basic kind of outcome studies and, like, retreat models. We saw that same, if you look at, like, the text fields of our UCL data, which we're still going through and will be published probably 2025-ish. There's telling a lot of the same story of, like, oh, I saw in a different way, and that different way afforded me a peace, or that different way afforded me a new context through which I could kind of see my own self or see others and things like this. And the this last study is just about, this is an LSD study. LSD is probably never going to be brought out of the bag again, ever. It's probably going to be like another analog. There's a MindMed study that's in phase 3 for ADHD right now, and generalized anxiety treatment as well, but they went from using LSD in phase 1 and 2 to now using a thing called MM120, which is like an LSD-like compound. But LSD will probably just remain illegal forever, everywhere on Earth, forever. But this was a study that was still conducted, and the main thing to take away here was that there was just elevated levels of oxytocin seen in like the blood oxytocin concentration, and that was like isolated to like this 2A agonist. And that might sound like a lot of mumbo jumbo to people that just showed up right now. But again, going back to like our kind of touchstone points in the beginning of like that pro-sociality, the trust and bond nature of oxytocin release, and the nature of LSD being able to potentially induce and increase oxytocin, blood oxytocin levels might potentially be therapeutic, and also confirming that LSD enhances like general empathetic processing. And it could also potentially be, again, because pharmacology is way more complicated than I can explain in 5 minutes of trying to explain this paper, which would normally be like a multi-session course in college to analyze. That effect might also be totally separate from the 2A receptor agonism. It could be something else, like metabolic, downstream, all these things of complex pharmacology. But from a subjective reporting level, these sorts of like pro-social connection, these general themes we hear about with the 2A agonists, like psilocybin or LSD, validated also in like a sort of blood oxytocin level. And last thing we'll touch on before we go to our 8 o'clock break is something just worth mentioning for like ethical considerations. Also, those of you who are maybe just like research oriented and interested in how these things progress. This was a psilocybin study in which it was conducted in mice recently. So the researchers used mice that were exposed to a compound known as valproic acid. It was introduced in utero in order to, it's sort of like they have developed a way in which these, they have like an agreed upon, like a way of modeling autism within the animal model. And the way of doing that is by giving valproic acid while the mice are pregnant. And those mice behave autistically when they are born. This is like, you know, it's an agreed upon, there's much more nuance. I'm speaking from I will acknowledge my bias. This is like somewhat like, I don't know, not the greatest of ways of like doing this type of research per se. But it is like known, and it speaks to the lens through which like we're looking at some of these things in empirical study. But in either case, like the social behavior as measured by durations of nose touches and other metrics was enhanced when psilocybin was administered. So like these are like steps and stages. A lot of this has to do with the ethics of doing human trials and having to start here. So like anyone who's like triggered by the idea that like mice touching noses means like give psilocybin to autistic people, it's like not the correlation. It's like a step and a stage, and they're also taking like blood draws. They're also like looking at other like other factors. But this is like one of the very few studies that happened previous to like the ones that are happening now. This is a study called Novamentis. They're developing, and they're targeting Fragile X syndrome, actually, which is a high comorbidity and way outside of my wheelhouse as far as knowledge goes. So as we look ahead to the next break, we're going to actually get into like talking about like psychedelics as care now, here, what's happening in Oregon. What are the points of access, and what can we do right in this moment, depending on like risk tolerance and other things. And also like by the fourth session later this evening, we'll then go into like where are we going like in 6 months from now, and what's that going to look like, and theoretically where are we going like 5 years from now when there's possibly psychedelics you can take home from the pharmacy, what would that look like? So, yeah, I just want to, like, before we go to break, I just want to still leave spaciousness, since it seemed like you guys are, like, reasonably well-fed, well-nourished-ish, give us, like, a 5-minute period of time where I still welcome further questions for now, and then we might just, we'll still have, like, the, like, 25 minutes after that, but I just want to free up some space for some discussion and that, just to hear from you guys, and I just want to thank you for just, like, sitting so stagnant, but if anyone has any questions or comments or anything they'd like to voice here. Before going to break?
I just want to say that valproic acid is Depakote. It's a medication given to people with bipolar disorder. I've been on it, so this is just anecdotal. But I mean, I think that I just want to like voice that the external appearance of being autistic versus the internal experience is very different, and the experience of being on Depakote is very different from being autistic. So I just wanted to put that out there.
Yeah, these things are used as like kind of like general like points of like they can tether a certain anything that can be tethered to like a metric that then becomes further measurable. Yeah, so it's not intended to be that way, and I'm simplifying it, and I
No, it's okay, I just wanted to add more nuance.
Yeah, no, for sure, and there's a lot of examples, and anyone who's ever been a med student or had to, like, do a lot of, like, mouse studies and things, it's a stressful happening. Any other thoughts before we go to break for now? Alright, well, I celebrate you guys being here for having the energy to continue to consume things, re-energize, get food, hit the cafe, and we'll be back here at 8:35, we'll get started again.